We asked you what topic we should cover on Science in Real Life, and you said photosynthesis. So we're really excited to bring you an episode that's going to show you an example of how scientists use photosynthesis in the lab. Science in Real Life. I'm Molly, and I'm here with our super special guest, Margaret Frank. She's a postdoc in the Chitwood Lab at the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center in St. Louis, Missouri.
Hi.
And Margaret was my graduate student mentor when I was an undergrad at Cornell, so we go way back.
So the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center is a not-for-profit research center that focuses on improving the human condition through plant science. There are 20 different labs housed here at the center, and they study really diverse topics from root architecture to flower development and plant disease resistance.
I just want to say how amazing it is to be here in Danforth and in St. Louis in general. It's this amazing hub of plant science research. There's something like 750 plant PhDs just in the area. I'm very, very excited.
So I studied plant grafting, which is simply the physical joining of separate plant parts. And this goes back thousands of years and is used to combine desirable traits from separate plants. So you can take your favorite fruit-producing shoot and combine it with a super robust rootstock, creating a plant that's disease-resistant, drought-tolerant, cold-tolerant, etc. And this has super important implications for food security. Today we're going to be grafting tomato plants. They're growing hydroponically in the growth chamber.
Let's get them.
For this experiment, we need a razor blade, plants, and grafting clips made from lanyard. So to graft these plants together, we simply cut the shoot of this plant and put it onto the root of the neighbor. Do you want to do the neighbor, Molly?
Yes.
And we're using these grafting clips to put them back together. So I'll put my shoot on Molly's plant.
And I'll put my shoot onto Margaret's plant.
So when you graft together the plants, the vasculature has to reconnect so that sugar and water can be transported between the roots and shoots. We're going to take them back to the growth chamber so that they can heal for 6 days. And now they're finally ready.
Well, now that we're done with our grafting experiment, I kind of feel like a plant surgeon.
Like a surgeon, grafting for the very first time.
So how do we know if our grafting experiment worked?
When farmers use grafting techniques on their crops, they wait to see if the grafted shoot heals and starts producing new leaves and fruit. But I'm researching exactly when the vasculature reconnects between the root and shoot, which we can't tell at this early stage simply by looking at the plant. Instead, we watch the transport of the products of photosynthesis.
So you've probably learned about photosynthesis at some point. It's the process by which plants make their own food. During photosynthesis, plant leaves take up carbon dioxide gas from the air and fix the carbon from the gas into sugars, which is their food. But the sugars need to get to the other parts of the plant, so they're transported in the vasculature down the shoot into the roots. In a grafted plant, this can only happen if the vasculature between the shoot and root has reconnected.
So to actually watch photosynthesis happen, we feed these plants radioactive carbon dioxide. To do this, we collaborate with a group at Washington University Medical School that has a PET imager, which stands for positron emission tomography. And this allows us to actually watch the radioactive carbon get turned into sugars in the leaves and move throughout the plant.
So if the carbon dioxide weren't radioactive, we would never be able to see it move through the plant, even if it were in the PET imager.
So to prepare these plants for the PET imager, we're going to seal them off so that we can feed them the radioactive carbon dioxide. To seal these plants, we use dental impression media. This is the same product that dentists use to take impressions of your teeth. And it can make an airtight seal around the base of the plant. Do you want to do one, Molly?
Yes, so badly.
You get 90 seconds before it hardens.
Wait, really? Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, okay. A lot of pressure. Pressure's on. Sealing it.
So now that the plants are all sealed, we're ready to take them to WashU Med School. Let's go! We made it.
And we're wearing all of this gear to protect ourselves from the radioactivity.
Before we start labeling the plants, we need to put them behind these lead shields that protect ourselves from the radiation. Then we're going to seal the plants in these chambers so that we can inject the radioactive carbon dioxide from the syringe that's shielded in tungsten, and then immediately transfer the plants into the PET imager.
And now the PET can do its thing, and then we can look at the results.
Now let's take a look at our data. If we open up plant number one, we can see that the lit up parts of the plant are where the radioactive carbon got incorporated. And you can see that it only incorporated into the shoot, which means the vasculature did not rejoin in this plant. So the graft from plant number one was not successful. Let's take a look at plant number two. So we can see that plant number two has radioactive carbon all the way down to the root of the plant, meaning that the graft was successful and the vasculature reconnected. So that was our data, but this technology is used for a lot of different plants. For example, corn plants.
In this example, we can see photosynthesis in action. So we can see the intensity of the radioactivity increasing in the corn shoots as they take in carbon dioxide and fix it into sugar via photosynthesis. And then here we can see the radioactive carbon getting transported into the roots of the corn. So the roots are getting more and more intensely lit up as the radioactive carbon accumulates. Margaret, this is so amazing. Can you tell us a little bit about how you're going to use experiments like these in your research?
Yeah, so I'm really interested in the communication between roots and shoots in grafted plants. And so once we know when functional vascular connection is formed between the roots and shoots, we can start sampling for the movement of things like RNAs and proteins between the two halves of the plant.
Margaret, thank you so much for joining us for this episode and showing us all the amazing plant science and technology here. You made all my plant dreams come true.
We're so happy to have you here at the Danforth Center.
If you want to know more about Margaret's work and other awesome research going on, you should check out the link to the Chitwood Lab. It's in the description. And don't forget to subscribe to Science in Real Life. You can do that by clicking up here, and we'll see you next time. This episode was brought to you by the American Society of Plant Biologists.